Christ, and we declare without hesitation or reservation that our God is worthy to be praised, and we declare that we are grateful that the Lord has kept us through another week and allowed us to come yet again on a Sunday morning to worship Him together in spirit and in truth. The words of the prelude are evenly, let some drops fall on me. And so, my brothers and sisters, wherever you are this morning, as you join us in worship, our prayer is that the drops of God's goodness, the drops of God's mercy, the drops of His love, the drops of His blessings would fall even on you, even where you are. So, my brothers and sisters, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. Won't you bow your heads with me? Gracious and eternal God, we've come once again in your presence and in your sight. And, oh God, we come first just to say thank you. We thank you, oh God, because you did stop by this morning and touch us with a finger of love. You woke us up and bid our golden moments to roll on just a little while longer. God, thank you that we can say we are still in the number one more time. Lord, we give you praise because you have not passed us by, and even us, deserving, undeserving, Lord, you have been good and gracious, and we thank you for this opportunity to worship you. And as we come together once again, Lord, in our living rooms, in our homes, in the sanctuary, with these who are here, God, I pray that your presence would fall fresh on even us, that at the end of our time together, we can say, surely the Spirit of the Lord is in this and in every place, and we will give you the glory, the honor, and the praise to your name. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. We continue in worship now as we shall be led by the Union Baptist Church Music Ministry. We're so grateful our skeleton crew is here. They may be a skeleton crew, but they can put some good meat on the bones. So pray for them as they shall lead us in worship through music. worship him together this day. My brothers and my sisters, if you are joining us from other places outside of our area, if you are not a member of the Union Baptist Church family, we want you to know that we are especially grateful to God's goodness for allowing you and for inspiring you to come and to worship with us this morning on this Memorial Day weekend. I hope that you will send up the sacrifice of praise before you set up or send up a few burnt offerings on your grill. If you're going to be outside today, we started out with a little cloudy weather, but I do believe that the clouds are going to move out. That's just like life. The clouds come, they gather, but in time they move out and the sun shines. God is always faithful and God will always see us through. And we want you to know that we indeed welcome you into this place to worship with us on today. Just a few items of housekeeping for our Union Baptist Church family, as well as those of you who are worshiping with us and would pray for us wherever you are. First of all, I do solicit prayers, as always, for all of those who are sick and shut in, for the bereaved families of our church. In particular today, we ask you to please keep in prayer the Reeves family, the Jackson family, and the loss of Linda Reeves, their sister, their cousin. Those services were this past week at Campbell Funeral Home. Please pray that the Lord would be with them as they continue to walk through this valley of the shadow of death. And then we solicit your prayers also on a number of fronts for those who are ill. In particular, I want you to remember the Williams family, Linda Williams, Linda's mother, Linda's father, Linda's sister. They've all been hospitalized, one with a confirmed case of COVID-19, others with results pending, but please keep them lifted up in your prayers. Also remember the Darrell Carmichael, a young man, he came along with my son, Sydney. They were about the same, or they are about the same age, and Darrell, the grandson of Sister Norma Carmichael, Brother Frank Carmichael, he is in quarantine, also having been diagnosed with COVID-19. And I ask you also to please keep in prayer Reverend Baker and his family. As you know, his wife, Yolande. Yolande is a nurse, and so she is one of those on the front lines, a health worker, and she had a scare, but this time the scare was real, and she has been diagnosed with COVID-19 and is in quarantine, and Reverend Baker, his test results are pending, as well as those of their daughters. So please keep them lifted up in your prayers. And let me say this to you, considering that prayer list, I want you to continue to pray. I want you to continue to worship. I want you to continue to be supported right where you are. Because guess what? We ain't coming back up in here right now. Amen. We are not coming back in this sanctuary right now. The sanctuary of God that we serve is everywhere at the same time. He can turn your house into a sanctuary. It ought to be a sanctuary. But just know that for the foreseeable future, Union Baptist Church will be engaging in virtual worship soon and very soon. I do believe that the restrictions have been lifted in terms of contractors, so we are moving forward as soon as we possibly can with being able to stream live from our website and not just depend on Facebook Live. We will still have Facebook Live, but that will not be our only way or only method and means to stream and to offer you the opportunity to worship with us from home. Right now, we will use what we have, and I want you to stay where you are. I don't care what any executive says until we hear from the King of Glory. We will not be in this sanctuary worshiping together as we normally would. Yes, my brothers and sisters, the church is essential. essential. That's no news bulletin. The church has always been essential for some of us, whether we know it or not. For some of us who claim it's not essential, let somebody die. Let somebody want a wedding. Then the church becomes essential. So whether we know it or not, the church is always essential. But guess what? You are the church wherever you are. And this is not the time for us to gather in a building. So we welcome you via live stream. We welcome you from your living room, from your kitchen table, from your bedroom, from any other room. Amen. We welcome you and we thank God that you are here, and we ask you to keep on praying and stay safe and to stay encouraged. We also want to ask you to please remember that the ongoing work of ministry must happen. We are still doing ministry. We may not be gathering, but we still have a commitment to do the word, to be the witness to the word, not just in what we say, but in what we do. We are feeding the hungry. We are clothing the naked. We are being supportive of efforts beyond what we do as a congregation in this community. And in this community, it is so vital in this time, because in New Jersey, I believe Mercer County still has a very high percentage of COVID-19 infections. I think maybe the second highest in the state, if I'm not mistaken. These things fluctuate from day to day. And I know that of the infections in Mercer County, most of the infections, the larger percentage, better than 40-something percent, are right here in these 7 square miles of Trenton, New Jersey. And we want to continue to do everything that we can to be of service, to be of help, and to be the hands and the feet of Jesus in this time. And we need your support to do so. So I'm asking you to please, if you are not already set up for online giving, please consider doing so. If not, just go to our website, www.ubctrenton.com. You'll find there instructions on giving. We ask you to please be supportive of the ongoing work of ministry here through this branch of Zion. If you are not a member of this congregation, but somehow you find yourself stopping by every week, it's good to eat at the restaurant, but sometimes you ought to at least leave a tip at the restaurant where you're eating. Amen. So if you are so moved and you are so inclined, even if you are not connected to this fellowship by membership, but perhaps you have established an online relationship, I encourage you, I ask you, if you are so moved, again, go to www.ubctrenton.com and share and sow into this ministry. I promise you that you are sowing into good ground. I thank you so much. As I say to you every week, and I can't stop saying it, I miss you so much. I love you. It was a great thing on this past Wednesday night. We returned to Bible study on Zoom, and we had better than 50 people in Bible study on Zoom. And for our first time out of the gate for a Bible study, it was a great time of fellowship. One of the things that was so wonderful was just seeing people want to say hey to each other. How you doing? I miss you. I haven't seen you in so long, and I miss your face. So listen, we will be back on Wednesday night. Those of you who receive our electronic communications, our members, you will have the access information, and we will be back in Bible study on Zoom this coming Wednesday night. Pray with us, pray for us, show up, and I promise this time, the waiting room will not be enabled. The waiting room will be enabled. We've on this past Wednesday on my Zoom, I think I have the waiting room enabled, and so everyone had to be manually admitted, which meant that when we began, some of you were not able to get in right away. Now, I've said that the Zoom waiting room is like that one being ushered at the door somewhere that won't let you in when you want to get in. Amen. But we're going to disable the waiting room, and whosoever will, let him come and listen. Whosoever will, you are welcome in this place and in your space of worship today. We sing to you and with you, our UBC Welcome and Fellowship song. If you've been stopping by a while now, you're learning it. If you don't know it, maybe somebody in the comments will help guide you through it. But come on, y'all help me, let's sing it. No longer I, but it's you and me. No more them, okay, but it's us and we. We're marching onward to the victory. Lord, for your goodness and your mercy toward us. We offer praise. We offer thanks. Lord, we rejoice because we realize that it has been that goodness and that mercy that has brought us and kept us all the days of our lives. And I ask you now, that goodness and mercy, Lord, let it find me in this moment. As we shall break unto your people the bread of life, Lord, may your goodness and mercy apply to our hearts. Spirit of living God, fall fresh on us. God, I ask you to take everything that I have and all that I'm lacking, my strengths and my weaknesses, all that I am and all that I am not, and use me in your service and for your glory. Do it, God, for your name's sake. Do it that your people might be blessed. Do it that somebody might know of your goodness and your mercy toward us. And we will give you the glory, the honor, and the praise, for we know you to be worthy. Hear us in Jesus' name, and for his sake I do ask it. Amen. Good morning to all the pictures and the views. Amen. We thank God for another day's journey, and we thank God for another week's journey. We wish you an enjoyable Memorial Day. For those of you who have friends and loved ones that you can remember who served and lost their lives in the service of this country, we want you to know that we remember and we celebrate with you and we honor their memory. Most of all, we've come today to honor the Lord of life. I don't have necessarily a Memorial Day message, but in a way, it is a memorial, not for those who are no longer with us, but a memorial of remembrance of a God who will never leave us. And it is with that in mind that I invite you this morning to consider with me what will be, for many of you, a familiar passage of Scripture. Guess what? Again, from the Old Testament, amen. From the 37th number of the Psalm, Psalm 37, just one verse. I have been young and now old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. That's really what I want to talk about today. Simply not forsaken. Not forsaken. I know many of you may have seen it because in these times a lot of us are on social media perhaps more than we normally would be. This time we're on there just trying to stay connected with people and not always necessarily trying to mind somebody else's business. Amen. But Facebook put together a commercial that has been running on both television and on social media featuring a Florida woman. I think her name is Anita Sampson. She's a centenarian, born in quarantine in 1920. It must have been during a spike in cases of the global flu pandemic that began in 1918 and really didn't end in earnest until around 1921. In his book, The Great great influenza. Historian John Barry tells the story of how within a span of 2 years from 1918 to 1920, at least 675,000 Americans died from the H1N1 flu strain, or as it was labeled then, the Spanish flu. When it swept over our country in waves, Anita Sampson was born in one of those waves. Now, 100 years old now, she has seen two pandemics and is once again in quarantine. The commercial featuring her was offered as both salute, or is offered as both salute and encouragement to women giving birth during the pandemic without the support of husbands, partners, or any significant others with them in labor and delivery, aside from doctors and medical staff. That has to be both frightening and disappointing for a mother, as well as a father who would otherwise be there. I have a lot of both faded and fading memories, but watching my children come into the world and the strength that my wife brought them into the world with, those are memories that remain vivid and meaningful, as vivid and meaningful today as they were in those moments. This thing is another experience COVID-19 is denying and will deny many couples. But it has been well said that there is nothing new under the sun. Packaging may change, but the substance of certain experiences remains the same. Anita Sampson's commercial speaks in this time of the same reality of the time into which she was born a century ago. And she says this: I was born during quarantine. I don't remember it, of course, but for my mother, it was a very difficult time. She told me it was just you and me for many months. But she wasn't alone. Everybody tried to do what they could to help, but she was also a very strong person. And when it was over, we came out into a new world, my mother and me. We can get through this. We all have the strength to do it. I'm 100 years old, and you just take care of that little miracle. We can get through this. We have the strength to do it. I'm 100 years old. I don't know anything about Anita Sampson's religious beliefs, or even if she has any at all. I do know, however, that she sounds so much like David in Psalm 37:25, saying, I have been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor a seed begging bread. We can't be sure how old David was when he wrote those words. Some biblical scholarship suggests that David didn't even write them. But if he did, and a literal biblical chronology of his life can be trusted, then he only lived to be about 70 years old, and then died, as 1 Chronicles 29:28 puts it, in a good old age full of days. These days, 70 doesn't seem so old, amen. I know plenty of active, fly as they want to be, septuagenarians who can still buy a piece or two out of the juice section of the department store. And they can pull it off as well, amen. 14 years from now, I hope to be one of them. But regardless of who said this or exactly how old they were when it was said, The fact that it was said at all is what matters the most. What matters most here is the retrospective witness of the faithfulness of God to those who trust in Him. Read the psalm in its entirety, and the writer's sense of trust becomes almost palpable as it is expressed through words and phrases like, "Do not fret because of evildoers, for they shall soon be cut off. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Rest in the Lord. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. A little while, and the wicked shall be no more. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Wait on the Lord." Woven in and out of practically every verse in this psalm are words of trust, stitching together the psalm like a garment of praise, testifying of God's care for His own. Being seated with the psalm is something like, at least it was for me, being seated in those Old Testament services of days gone by. You do know church was already different before it got this difference. And this psalm has a way of carrying me back to a time when what we now call praise and worship, and it's generally all about singing, was back then called devotion and included both singing and testifying. Psalm 37:25 carries me back to a time when elders and ancestors of the faith, saints full of years, would, if they could, struggle to their feet, even the way they pulled themselves up. Something about the way they struggled up seemed sacred. And they would stand beneath the weight of time and speak out of the wealth of their years of experience with faith in God. They'd say things like this: "I want to thank the Lord for my being here. I could have been dead, no, sleeping in the grave. And I'm thankful that my bed last night was not my cooling board and my cover was not my winding sheet. God's grace and mercy have been keeping me down through the years. Lord's been good to me." They say things like, "If it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I would be. The Lord has brought me from a mighty, mighty long way. And I've come too far with God to turn around now." They say things like, "I don't believe the Lord brought me this far just to leave me. I know the Lord will make a way somehow. Yes, He will." They say things like, "Every day hasn't been easy. I've had some hard times. I've had to cry sometimes. I walk the floor at night sometimes. But I declare, if you just keep on praying and trusting and wait on the Lord, I'm a living witness that God will hear and answer prayer." They didn't use David's words exactly, and sometimes they even misused some of their own words, but the message was the same. "I have been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread." Moreover, the striking thing is that many of the old saints offering testimonies like that had in fact experienced both hunger and poverty. I've heard testimonies like that coming out of the mouths and the hearts of people I know for myself during the course
get something to eat again. And if I'm brutally honest this morning, which I am going to be, their testimonies about not seeing the righteous forsaken nor a seed begging bread have always carried more weight with me than David's testimony. David was, after all, a king. And if anybody was going to eat, the king was going to eat. Amen. Empire, both then and now, works to preserve itself. That we know for sure. But there is a significant difference in that dynamic between David's time and our time. And that is the fact that in David's day, righteousness was understood as being imputed not just to individuals in particular, but also to a nation in general. David led a righteous nation, so righteous that in his kingdom, people could glean in the fields as a matter of law. And gleaning in the fields really was just a legally protected opportunity for the poor to gather leftovers from the fields in harvest time. Farmers were not permitted to go back over the fields they harvested to pick up any leftover wheat or grain. As a matter of fact, they were not even permitted to harvest the corners of their fields. Whatever grew in the corners of the fields had to stay there. They could make only one round, picking olives off the trees or picking grapes off the vines. As a matter of fact, they were commanded by law to always leave something available in the fields and in the vineyards to provide for the poor. They could not just rake the land and pick the bones dry and hoard everything for themselves. David lived in a righteous nation that did not lend itself to people begging bread. In a righteous nation, children would not have to go to bed hungry. In a righteous nation, nobody would seek to underfund, defund, and eliminate programs to help feed the poor. In a righteous nation, governors would not rush to reopen businesses in a pandemic just to push people off unemployment rolls and force workers to choose between health and safety and putting food on the table. In a righteous nation, as a matter of law, there will always be enough left in the field to feed people, insure people, and help people to live with dignity and respect, not just before they are born, but after they are born. By those standards, you and I are not children of a righteous nation. We are children of a capitalist nation. We are children of a dog eat dog, I got mine, now you get yours nation. We live in a nation where the prevailing myth is we are an egalitarian society with a level playing field for all, while the persistent reality is that we are an elitist society in which them that's got shall have, and them that's not shall lose against deeply entrenched systems of discriminatory and exploited practices in taxation, employment, education, voting, predatory lending, judicial sentencing, and then some. And if you are on the losing end, it's simply because you are lazy and want somebody else to take care of you. And why should my tax dollars, why should my field have to do the job? And we'll call you a loser straight out of 2 Corinthians. Y'all will get that later. With our mouths while holding a Bible in our hands and screaming to the top of our voice that we are a Christian. Christian nation while we go right on ignoring the same Christ who said we are never more like him than when we give food to the hungry, water to the thirsty, welcome to the stranger, clothing to the naked, care to the sick, and love to the prisoner. It's a hard truth, but it is true that many, particularly people of color, we remember who died in the service of this country, died more for something they hoped we would be, and less for something that we are. We are not the children of a righteous nation, but we are the children of a righteous God. A righteous God whom we trust that through the life, through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, imputes, passes on, or makes us right in his sight, even when we are not right in people's sight. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, the Apostle Paul says, believers, become the righteousness of God. It's not the righteousness of we ourselves that is not forsaken. If that's what we had to depend on, David would have said, I've never seen the perfect forsaken, which would mean all of us are forsaken. But this unforsaken righteousness of which the psalmist speaks is that righteousness that hides our lives in the life of the one who both gave his life and then reclaimed his life, that we too might have life and that more abundantly, and live as righteous people even in an unrighteous world. We are the righteousness of God in Christ. And God does not forsake his own. People may forsake us, but not God. Institutions may forsake us, but not God. We are not forsaken. We may, however, be redirected. Don't confuse the two, forsaken and redirected. I think people sometimes do that, especially in times which are many, when we don't understand life events, how they are unfolding both in the world in general and in homes and in our lives in particular, or in those moments when it slips our minds that God's answer to prayer just might be no, or in those moments when a door that God clearly once had opened is now being shut. But we would do well to remember that while God by nature is immutable and unchangeable, he is not so by methodology. You read 1 Kings when the prophet Elijah prophesied to King Ahab and Queen Jezebel that there would be no rain in the land except by his word for 3 years. God sent him to a brook by Cherith, where in the midst of drought he enjoyed water and had meal sent airmail from ravens. But one day the brook dried up and the ravens stopped coming, not because God had forsaken him, but because God was redirecting him to the house of a widow in a place called Zarephath. God also redirected the widow and her son to feed, to use the last they had to feed the prophet. But ultimately, Elijah, the woman, her son, all of them would be blessed with more than enough, because God will not forsake, but he may redirect. Just because you lose a job, just because you lose an opportunity, lose a relationship, lose an advantage, lose an in, lose an out, lose maybe even everything, does not mean God has forsaken you. He just may be redirecting you. I thought about this even further in the context of what we're experiencing during this pandemic. When last week I got a text from one of our deacons saying, ain't this crazy? In spite of quarantine, I see good things happening. bluer skies and cleaner waterways and animals reappearing all over the world. Biological and church families realizing how much they love and miss each other. I've seen it too. Glennis and I were taking a walk last week, and in less than a minute saw a fox, a wild turkey, and a deer all within a few feet of each other. And then a colleague said this to me. He said, "Man, I'm missing some folk I don't even like." God has not forsaken us, but it does seem as if God may be redirecting us, redirecting how we prioritize and value our time with Him, with ourselves, with others. I don't know how long we'll be out of the church building, and I'm not going to worry about it either, because I know that God has not forsaken us, but He may be redirecting us, redirecting how we understand and envision what it means to worship Him and to serve Him, not in buildings, not in what we wear, not in what we set up to enhance the physical aesthetics of our gatherings, but to worship Him in spirit and in truth right where we are. Maybe God is redirecting how we assess, determine, and evaluate what it means to be blessed and better than blessed, redirecting how much time we waste majoring in minors and straining in gnats and swallowing camels, redirecting how we understand what it means to live righteously, not just individually, but collectively. And in so doing, pass on a legacy of righteousness to generations yet to come, and to whom God also promises to be faithful. Let me share this with you, something I shared in Bible study on June Wednesday night, and I'll be done. I shared with them how back in December, UBC Deacon sent Glennis and I away for a weekend in Hershey Park. We stayed at the Hotel Hershey. We really enjoyed that well-maintained elegance of bygone days and all the holiday decorations. While we were there, we went to the Hershey Museum. And I saw there the story of chocolatier Milton Hershey and how he built a business empire, a still thriving school in a Pennsylvania town. He even had one in Cuba for a while. I didn't know that. He did all of that with a vision from Candy. But of all that we saw on display in the museum, the thing that struck and stays with me the most is a canceled check that Hershey had written to the White Star Line for $300 in December of 1911 to book his passage on the Titanic, which would sail and sink in the Atlantic 4 months later. Business concerns caused him to take an earlier ship. But if that had not been the case, all that we were enjoying that weekend in December 2019 might have sunk to the floor in April of 1912. And I just stood at that display case, staring at that canceled check. And yes, the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart with this thought. And it was simply this: God will never let you sink before time. He may redirect you, but He will neither forsake you nor what He has ordained to be your legacy. So I came this morning to tell you that no matter how long our lives may be or how short they may be, no matter what time may bring our way, yes, we can get through this. Yes, we have the strength to do it. God's got us. We are not forsaken. You just take care of and hold on and trust in that miracle called faith, and you will not sink. How long will we be in the house? Who knows? But we are not forsaken. How long will it take for there to be a vaccine? Who knows? But we are not forsaken. How long will we be struggling through this? Who knows? But we are not forsaken. How long will we stay? out of this building. Who knows when we are not forsaken? And I know this table is not the only witness. Somebody listening to me today is also a witness. Somebody listening to me today can say, ain't it crazy? Every index in my profile says I should have sunk a long time ago. All of the statistics about the circumstances of my birth, about my race, about my mama, about my daddy, about my gender, about my economic status, about my education, about my city, about my job, about my life, all of those things say I shouldn't be here today, but here I am, because God did not forsake me. I experienced, after all of the things that came my way in an unrighteous society, I met a righteous God. He did not forsake me, but sometimes he did redirect me. He did not always move the mountain, but he did give me strength to climb. He did not always take away the stumbling blocks, but he did lead me all around. Somebody listening to me today, I don't care how old you are, you can say like David, I've not seen the righteous forsaken, nor received any bread. Somebody listening to me today, we ought to turn the comment section into an old-fashioned testimony service. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so if he heals your body. Say so if he provided for you. Say so if he rocks you. Say so if he held you. Say so if you know that you know that you know that you know that you've come through situations that human intellect and human ingenuity could not work out for you. Say so if you trust that we are not forsaken. Say so.
blessed assurance of your word that we are not forsaken. God, we come now to ask you to not go, but just open up the hearts of your people. Those who in this moment are in need of comfort. Those in need of healing. Those in need of provision. Those, oh God, who are worried about children and spouses and grandchildren, family members, friends. God, I ask you right now to saturate them with your spirit, to remind them that they are not forsaken, that you have not abandoned them, and that you will not abandon them. God, I pray in the name of Jesus for every weary soul. God, in the midst of this, Lord, there are many uncertainties, there are many questions. We don't know sometimes which way to turn, but one thing we do know, you are still able, you are still God, and you will not forsake us. So God, in the midst of trouble, in the midst of struggle, Lord, give us the joy of our salvation. Lord, if you don't move the mountain, thank you right now for the strength to climb. If you don't move the problem, thank you for the way around the problem. If you don't part the river, God, thank you for a bridge over troubled waters. Thank you that you will never leave nor forsake us. Thank you that our lives are in your hands. Not just now, but in eternity. God, you do not forsake us even in death. For to be absent from the body, you've told us, is to be present with the Lord. Lord, comfort and remind those who are grieving of their promise this day, that even the lives of their loved ones that they have bid farewell to, those lives are in your hands. They have not been forsaken. And oh God, forgive us. God, forgive us for all the times when we've mistaken being redirected for being forsaken. Lord, we don't always know what life is going to bring us, but we've got confidence that you are going to see us through. And any way you bless us, any way you lead us, any way you guide us, God, we will be satisfied. We love you. We thank you and we trust you. Keep us now until we meet again. Safe, secure, hold us in the hollow of your hand. And we, whose lives are hidden with you, the righteousness of Christ, you will not forsake, and our seed will not be begging bread. This is our prayer. This is our hope. This is our trust and our confidence. Someone who needs to be reminded that they have not been forsaken. someone who knows of themselves that although we live in an unrighteous world, we do have a righteous God who will do right by his own. My benediction today, and this is for my old saints, we didn't sing a hymn today. We're one of those churches where we still embrace those, but can I just leave you with this reflection?